Good everyone, my name is Alex and welcome to a new review. So if you like the Samsung Galaxy S7 Edge but it is a bit too expensive and you don't want to buy a fake Samsung Galaxy S7 Edge, well now there is another option, the Elephone S7. So this is basically a copy of the Samsung Galaxy S7 Edge but on a budget. So this phone costs around $250 and you can actually get this cheaper depending on the specs that you want. The one that I have has the Helio X20 processor. This is a very powerful processor. We have 4 gigs of RAM, 64 gigs of internal storage, and running Android 6.0.1. We also get a 5.5-inch screen with a 1080p resolution. Now, the company says that the phone has a curved screen, so both edges are curved. However, in reality, only the glass covering the screen is curved, so the screen underneath the glass is not actually curved. I know that could be disappointing for some of you, but in reality, you're barely gonna notice the difference. The screen gets very bright, has awesome vibrant colors, and the viewing angles are also good. And on top of that, we even have some type of scratch-resistant glass. So I tried to scratch the phone on a couple of occasions, and it doesn't seem to get scratched. You can also touch the screen in 5 places in the same time and the screen will register. However, the screen sensitivity on this device is not the best. I found myself on many occasions trying to type something and I have to like press the same letter a couple of times for the screen to register. So the screen sensitivity should be improved and maybe that's gonna be possible in the future software update. And since we are still on the front of the device, on top of the screen we have the speaker, we have a LED notification light, and this notification light can change colors. However, it's a very, very small notification light. And aside from that, we have a 5-megapixel front-facing camera. That front-facing camera, like most cheaper Chinese devices, it's not the absolute best. So if you take pictures in daylight, the pictures will turn out okay. But at nighttime, there is a lot of noise in the pictures. And these are a couple of examples of pictures that I took with the front-facing camera. And lastly, all the way at the bottom of the device, we are gonna find the home button, and we don't actually have a multitasking button or a return key. So those buttons are actually built in the home button. And the home button is also a fingerprint scanner. Now the fingerprint scanner, it's accurate, I would say 9 out of 10 times, but it is a bit slow. So all you have to do is actually touch the fingerprint scanner, you don't actually have to push it all the way in, and the screen will get unlocked. But as I said before, it's not the absolute fastest and it's gonna take like half a second every time you unlock the screen. To use the multitasking button, all you have to do is keep that home button pressed for a couple of seconds and the multitasking menu will open. If you want to go back, all you have to do is just touch the home button. And if you want to go to the home screen, you have to push on it. So it takes a while to actually get used to it, but after you get used to it, it's very easy to do. So even though we have a 5.5-inch screen, I find that the phone is small enough to actually be used with one hand. Again, it really depends how big your hands are, but I was actually able to use this phone just by holding it in one hand. Moving to the back of the phone. So the back of the phone, it's made out of this shiny plastic. However, this shiny plastic gets scratched very, very easy. So no matter where you put the phone down, basically the back is gonna get a scratch. So be very careful whenever you set this down, and it would be ideal if you actually use a case. So on the back we are gonna find the 13-megapixel camera, the flash, and the Elephone logo. The thing that I dislike the most about this phone is how that plastic back feels when it meets the frame. So the frame and the plastic back don't seem to meet in the exact same spot, and that frame actually digs in your hand whenever you're holding the phone. So I know this is a cheaper device and it's not gonna feel as nice and good as a Samsung device, but that's something that I think it could have been improved and it wouldn't have been that expensive to do so. And since we are talking about that metallic frame, on the right hand side of the phone you're gonna find the power button and the volume keys, and of course these ones are also made out of metal. On top of the device you're gonna find the 3.5mm audio jack, and the sound coming out of this 3.5mm audio jack, it's on par with most Chinese devices, around $200, so it's decent but nothing special. And moving to the right hand side of the phone, you're gonna find the SIM card tray slot. So you can either use 2 SIM cards in this phone or a SIM card and an SD card. And since we have Android 6.0.1 running on this device, you can easily insert and install that SD card as internal memory. So that's a big bonus. And lastly, all the way at the bottom of the device, you're gonna find what looks to be like two speakers. However, only one of them it's a speaker, the other one it's the microphone. You're also gonna find a micro USB port there, so this phone will take about 2 hours, 2 hours and 20 minutes to be fully charged. And this phone also supports OTG, so you can plug in any USB stick to that micro USB port there, and the phone will be able to read whatever you have on that USB stick. As for the sound coming out of that speaker at the bottom there, well, the phone does get quite loud, however, it seems a bit distorted at the maximum volume. And here is a sample of how the speaker sounds. The non-removable 3000 mAh battery inside this phone, it's not the absolute best, so you will be able to make it through an entire day if you're not a very heavy user. So I was able to get around 3 hours of screen on time, and that's basically enough for most people to make it through an entire day, but for some you may actually have to charge this phone twice throughout the day. Performance wise, I was kind of expecting a bit more from this phone considering that we have 4 gigs of RAM, so we get an AnTuTu benchmark score of about 77,000 and a multi-core score of about 3700 on the Geekbench 4, so a bit lower than other devices with the exact same processor. The Elephone S7 gets Android 6.0.1 with Elephone's own skin on top of it. Now, I'm very happy to say that the skin that they use is very close to stock Android. So if you're used to stock Android, this looks just like that. So moving between screens, moving between apps, it's done very fast without any glitches. And the multitasking on this phone is excellent. So you can keep a lot of apps running in the background. So those 4 gigs of RAM that we have help a lot for multitasking, and this is probably one of the best phones for multitasking under $250 that I've seen in quite some time. The settings app, it's fairly simple, we don't get too many added features. There are some smart features there that I couldn't actually use because they're pointless, but we do have the option to actually have on-screen buttons. So if you don't like the setup with the one home button for everything, you can also add those on-screen buttons. So aside from that, for storage you get about 54 gigs out of that 64 that comes with the phone. So 54 gigs of storage is a lot of storage, and the phone supports a lot of languages like most of these Chinese devices. The GPS unit inside the Elephone S7, it's okay, but it's not spectacular. So it takes a few seconds to actually connect to the satellites. But if you drive in between tall buildings, it will lose signal every now and then. Again, we've seen that for many devices in the past, so yeah, it's not the absolute best. For sensors, we do have some sensors there, but some of them don't actually seem to work, so I'm not sure why they included those. So yeah, that's what we get with this phone. I was expecting that a lot more sensors would be available considering that this is a $250 device. The 13 megapixel camera on the back of this phone, it's actually better than I was expecting. So first of all, the camera app, it's the same camera app that we've seen for many MediaTek devices, and we don't have that many options, and frankly the camera app sucks. Whenever you take pictures with the HDR mode on, you have to hold your hand very steady for like 2-3 seconds till the phone actually takes the pictures. So that is a bit annoying. But there is one option that I've seen that I haven't actually seen in quite some time, so the possibility of actually taking pictures in RAW. That gives you a lot of editing possibilities with the pictures that you took. Now, for quality of the pictures, for nighttime pictures, the pictures turned out better than I was expecting. So again, if you hold your hand very steady for 2-3 seconds, you're actually gonna be able to take some decent looking pictures, and you're looking at some pictures that I actually took with this phone. For daytime pictures, the same deal. If you hold your hand very steady and you take your time, the pictures turn out quite good, and I was quite impressed, to be honest, because I was actually expecting that the camera on the back would suck. Now regarding the phone's connectivity, so we have dual band Wi-Fi, that means that you can connect to the 2.4 and the 5 GHz Wi-Fi networks, and the speeds that I got over Wi-Fi were quite decent. Now, if you look on the manufacturer's website, it's gonna show you the bands that are supported by this phone, but that would mean that this phone would never work in Canada. So I wasn't actually expecting that I would actually get signal on 3G with this phone in Canada. but for some reason it actually gets connectivity on 3G, but it only works sometimes. So connectivity with this phone, it's strange, and I'm not sure which of the bands are actually available and what bands are not available. So yeah, I'm not sure about the bands. I tried to contact the manufacturer, but I didn't actually get an answer. So the bands that are actually listed on their website may not be totally true. Whenever the 3G was working, the speeds were appropriate as well, but again, sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't, so I'm not sure what the bands on this phone are. I've also tried a whole bunch of apps on this phone. So for example, Chrome, after the page loads, you can zoom in, zoom out, scroll and everything like that without any issues. Keep in mind that that processor that we have, it's rather powerful. Other apps like Twitter, for example, the same deal. After it loads, you can scroll through those feeds and stuff like that without any issues. On the YouTube app, you can also watch videos at 1080p, and that's a good thing. That's basically the maximum resolution of the screen, and the videos seem to go very smooth as well. As for gaming, you can basically play any game available in the Play Store. So no matter what game it is, this processor and that amount of RAM will do just fine. And keep in mind that the multitasking on this phone, it's really, really good. So you can keep a whole bunch of apps running in the background, and the phone, it's not gonna kill them. And it's time to conclude this video. So if you're looking for a Samsung Galaxy S7 Edge on a budget, this could be it. I mean, the phone does look very, very nice from the front. The back, it's not my favorite. That plastic on the back just ruins the phone for me. But for this much money, you can actually get a whole bunch of other phones. So for example, the Xiaomi Redmi Note 4 has the exact same processor, 3 gigs of RAM, 64 gigs of internal storage, and the build quality on that one is much better. However, the RAM management is better on the Elephone S7. Also, the camera is better on this one, but the battery life on this one, it's not as good as that Xiaomi phone. So there are a whole bunch of things to take into consideration. So it really depends on your taste and how much you like a closer to stock Android experience. So overall, it's a good phone, but it does need a whole bunch of improvements. My biggest issue with it was the screen sensitivity and the connectivity, because I'm not sure where this phone is gonna work, because they say some bands in the specifications, and some bands work, some bands don't. So yeah, it's a big mess. Hopefully you guys enjoyed this video, and if you did like it, press that like button, don't forget to subscribe, and I'll see you in the next one. Thanks for watching.